Hey everybody, Larry Sparks here with another Prophetic Perspective interview. I am so excited to talk with Julie Winter today. Let me tell you what, for those of you in the Bethel community, so our friends out in Reading, Julie Winter is a name that you will recognize, you'll know. What I love about Julie is that she blends the supernatural, which we all love, which obviously Destiny Image has been founded to expand that message, but she blends together the supernatural, but also the practical and medical. I actually feel, Julie, as we get ready to talk, I want people to hear a little bit of your history, and I want you to give them a little bit of context of where you're coming from. And for all of you guys who are watching right now, listen, I can go back and forth between screens. Julie, you can't see this. You probably either just see me or you see one stagnant screen. But the cool thing is when I go to you and I have you talk, I can go right and it'll just be a screen.
Oh, great.
You're addressing everybody. So, Julie, again, as we begin this interview, we're talking about her new book, Renew, and all these exciting things. But I want you, Julie, to just tell people a little bit about your story, who you are, what you do, because I think it's a powerful context.
Wonderful. And thank you, Larry, for having me on. I'm honored to be on this program. So I'm a family nurse practitioner. I have a master's degree in nursing from UCLA, and I've been doing that for about 30 years now. I've lived in Reading for some time. And so I just see patients in the office, in family practice. I treat a lot of anxiety and depression. In California, we have had diminished funding for mental health. So that's caused family practice providers to treat a lot of mental health. So I would say a good 10 to 20, probably closer to 20% of my practice is treating mental health conditions. So I treat a lot of anxiety and depression. And coming to that subject as a believer, as a faith-filled believer, and that brings a perspective of the spirit realm. But we also have to understand that the brain is an organ, just like any other organ in the body. And so it can be affected by the physical realm. I believe that we are a triune being and that we are body, mind, and spirit. And anxiety and depression can be rooted in any of those three areas. So there's no one treatment that works for everybody, so to speak. So I wanted to bring about a resource for my patients who often would feel that anxiety or depression was rooted in the spiritual realm or just maybe perhaps in their mind, when it can be much more than that. So I wanted to bring about a practical resource. This book was written at the request of my patients, who I would speak with and talk with and give them tips and points. And they say, could you have a resource on that? And I didn't only just what was in my head from years of practical experience. So this book is a compilation of practical experience that addresses the body, mind, and spirit. It's a very holistic approach.
Well, one of my favorite parts of this book, and I remember when you and I were kind of talking about the layout and structure and all that.
Yes.
One of my favorite chapters, and man, I feel like I might just kind of turn you loose a moment to minister on this, because
Okay. Here's
the deal. All of our folks who are watching and listening, and you know, I mean, we get all sorts of folks, thousands of views, and the reality is so many people are going through depression. So many people are going through anxiety.
Yes.
And I love, Julie, it's not just the church world and charismatic world. We have this, like, we want to, like, cast everything out of everybody and rebuke everything. And there's a place
right.
for that. Believe me.
Right.
I published books that'll tell you how to do that. But at the same time, I really feel like one of the things that your book talks about is that the Lord wants his people to have a revelation of their factory setting.
Yeah.
Their default setting, which is joy. And I love that's the first chapter of this book. I feel like when you have a vision for what God has meant your life to look like,
yes,
you can use a plan and ask him for wisdom on how to get back there. So, Julie, without further ado, can you just share a little bit about that? What does it mean for joy to be the default setting of our lives?
Yes, and I love that statement. Joy, we need to live from a position of joy. Joy is our strength. And we have joy in the Lord. The kingdom of the Lord is righteousness, peace, and joy. And as my friend Chris Valentin says, two-thirds of the kingdom is felt. And so it needs to be our MO. If we don't have joy, then something's wrong. It's kind of like having a fever. It doesn't matter what the circumstances we're facing. The world around, the Lord is for we are living in us. The Holy Spirit lives and dwells in us. So we have access then to the kingdom of God. We have access to joy. So that is our default. And it also is our fragrance to a dying world. And if we don't have joy, then how can we minister to the world around us? Because that is that fragrance of the Holy Spirit. People are attracted to joy. And I think sometimes people feel guilty about feeling joyful because there is there are hard things that are around us. We are surrounded by media that is, you know, shouting bad news at us. And so sometimes it's almost like it feels foreign to be full of joy. And yet you should wake up every morning with a sense of joy and anticipation of what the Lord is going to do. So if that's not the case, then something's wrong.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. I love that, Julie, what you were talking about. I mean, I feel like the Lord is just wanting to release that fragrance of joy.
Yes. It is the fragrance. Yes.
That's I love that language. Julie, can you tell our folks out there, because I feel like, again, I'm going to be a shameless promoter because I published this and I believe in this message, but Renew. What I love about the book, though, is that it starts with joy, which is your factory setting, the default. Mm-hmm. And if you're convicted, or if you're, I don't even like to use that word sometimes because there's such baggage. If you're sensing, I'm not walking in that joy. I don't have that deep abiding joy. And I'm going to have Julie in a moment just differentiate happiness and joy. But if you're not at that place, I've got good news. The Lord has given a message to Julie. The whole book, starting, I believe, from chapter 2 and really to chapter 18, is all about if you are not operating in the default setting of joy, it's a real strategy to help you, just give you some practical tips on, okay, these are some ways, these are things you can integrate that will help bring you back. And almost like I see the Lord in the Spirit, like resetting your dial to get you back right. To that setting. So, Julie, like you were just saying, in an atmosphere in a world where there's so much bad news, we're bombarded with things that are the opposite of joy. What is the difference between having deep abiding joy and just kind of having happiness, which kind of comes and goes?
Yeah. So, you know, I feel like joy is just like a core value, a place where you live, and you can still be sad about a situation, but still have a core sense of joy in your spirit. Like you said, happiness can come and go, but joy is actually a choice. I believe that we actually choose to live out of joy. And I tell the story of a gentleman who he and his wife had come out to Reading for supernatural healing. His wife had metastatic ovarian cancer, and they had lived here for a year, and I worked with them, and they went to the healing rooms, and they went through all the Western medical treatment for cancer, and yet she died. And I can remember speaking to him 2 days after her death. I called him to see how he was doing, and he said, "I am so grateful to you, Julie. I am grateful for the medical profession, for the care that we got. I'm grateful for the Bethel community, for the support that we got. Even though my wife died, I still have joy because I know where she is. And although I grieve for her, my heart is still full of joy." And I thought, what an incredible example of being in the storm, being in the midst of grieving, but still living, choosing joy and not, and it was just amazing to me. And so it doesn't matter what you're facing. I talk about Corrie ten Boom and her sister, you know, in the prison camp, and how they chose to look at the good, how they chose joy. So I just think that we have a lot more power to choose it. We you know, our circumstances come and go, but in the midst of that, we have the Lord no matter what. You think about what Paul wrote in prison. He wrote Philippians, and, you know, rejoice in the Lord always, chapter 4, that whole section. That was written from a man who was being persecuted in prison. So joy is ours. Always, we always have access to it.
Well, and I love that, because I mean, that's a powerful reality that people need to grab hold of, because happiness tends to be dependent on how we're feeling. And like you said,
yes.
Folks,
yes.
You can actually be unhappy and still have joy. That's bizarre, but that's kingdom. Yeah. There can be things that grieve you, that cause you to mourn. God doesn't want you to like throw out all your emotions. But Julie, you said something so powerful, and I feel like this book, this message is going to help you do it. It's going to show you how to initiate joy.
Yes,
I feel Holy Spirit on that, because each one of these things talks about rooting out lies that are destructive.
Yes, yes.
Your the armor of God talks about things you actually proactively do. You don't wait for revival service. You don't wait for hands to be laid on you. You don't have to wait for certain things.
Right.
Julie, if I'm correct, there are certain things believers, really anybody can do, but I know that there's a message here for believers. They can kind of take it into their own hands. It's like, you know what? I'm going to take a step to secure joy for my life.
Yes. And I think it's so important to understand that we are commanded to take our thoughts captive. Yes. We're not commanded to take our feelings captive. And that's where people get hung up. We want to take our feelings, like you feel angry or you feel sad and you want to try to take control of that. It doesn't work. You have to take the underlying thought captive and then your feelings change. The feelings are the fruit. You know, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Those are the fruits of the Spirit. They grow from the trees of our minds. And I have a whole chapter about that. And it's really important because when you control what you think, you control what you feel. And so, and sometimes there's a lag, and that's where people get lost because they feel real anxious about something. I think you need to use your feelings as a thermometer to gauge. The thermometer tells you what's wrong. So if you're feeling angry, you're feeling anxious, you still have to stop and think, okay, well, you can't say I'm not going to feel anxious. You say, what is the thought that's generating that? And you go back to the thought and you take it back to the lie, because there's always a lie that's generating the feeling, so to speak. So every thought that you have has a chemical reaction and it produces something, either good or bad. And so that's why we have to take our thoughts captive.
I mean, Julie, again, I'm the publisher, so I should know this about the book, but even as we're talking about it, I feel like the Lord even has a word for you, Julie, as we're doing this and after your book, is that this, I'm looking just through the chapter titles and everything, and again, you and I, you know, I remember looking at this in its infancy, but my goodness, what you're giving people, and I want to encourage our viewers and those watching now or the archive, this book, whether for yourself or somebody else, I believe it gives you instruction on how to take your life back. And I want to say that with you know, it's like what I love about Julie is, again, you know, if you need counseling, go to a counselor. If you need medicine, go to the doctor. You know, that's true. We're not.
Yes.
But I really feel like the principles in this book, more than any I've read in recent years, are they're all proactive in terms of, okay, God, your standard for my life is joy. How do I get there? Okay, forgive.
Yeah.
I recognize thoughts that are destructive and take every thought back. It's all this, Julie, I read this, and it was funny, you and I were talking, one of the categories for the book is spiritual warfare. And it's like, well, I don't know about that. You know what? I believe that was actually prophetic that it was categorized that way, because it actually is, it is offensive warfare.
Joy is offensive.
It puts the believer in a place to actually move forward with authority. So again, my last little statement here in turn, I encourage you, if you need this kind of book for perpetual anxiety, depression, you're dealing with that stuff, by all means, pray to the Holy Spirit about counsel, all that kind of stuff. There's nothing wrong with that. There's no guilt in that. But I believe this book is a great place to start. Julie, let me ask you this question. What is your vision for people who read this book and kind of go through the process and put this into place in their life? What would you like to see this produce in people?
I think number one, I want to say, let's break off the shame of pursuing treatment. I have so many people who come in to see me. I'm their last resort. And they have prayed and meditated or seen a counselor, and they're so ashamed that they have to come in to perhaps pursue medicine. And I want to say, I want to remind people that our brain is an organ, and there are some people who really need medication. For whatever reason, their brain does not produce enough neurotransmitters, perhaps serotonin or dopamine, those kinds of things. And medication is an incredible useful tool. It's one that's in my arsenal. I use it wisely, I use it judiciously, but many believers are so opposed to medication. And I just want to break off the shame of that. That's really, really important, incredibly important. I mean, I see staff people, pastors, who do so much better on medication. And you take the medication away and they are not able to maintain mood because there's dysfunction in the brain, just like you can have dysfunction in your pancreas and, you know, be a diabetic. So let's break off the shame of treatment. And then let's go after truth. I think that's so important. Much of what people believe, how we have talked about the trees of our mind, our tree of faith versus tree of unbelief. You got to get down to the lies. Much of what we fear and anxiety are generated by lives. And often are harshest with real. I have a section of some key base foundational lies that I find that are very common. So, you know, going after that, getting into the presence of the Lord, worship. There's nothing more transformative than spending time with the Lord and showing, letting him show how much he loves you. I think the more we know and get into the presence of the Lord and know his love, love is greater than anything. When we know how much we're loved, then we can feel confident in our life. We can feel confident in our future no matter what we face.
I love that. I'm looking through the contents right now. I want to encourage people. Again, if you can, I see some comments now, people saying, I want to buy that book. You can go to Amazon to get the book.
Correct.
You can go to Bethel Media, to go to the Bethel store. Julie, right. Do you have a website where they can go and learn more about you personally?
Let's see. I think you could probably go to juliewinter.com. There's definitely information on my website, juliewinter.com. I'm a city council member as well, so you'll see city council stuff, but you can see my bio there, and you can see some information about the book. The book is available on Barnes & Noble as well.
Yeah.
So, Barnes & Noble, Amazon, or the Bethel bookstore.
It is wherever books are sold. Most likely you will even see it at your local bookstore. When I was in Reading, I saw they had a nice little end cap with the book sticking out. And cool thing is this. I mean, again, I just want to give you a little preview in terms of what this book is all about, in terms of tools that I believe, Julie, you put in people's hands that actually help them take back their thought life. You know, it's funny. I was saying take back your life, and I've heard people, but I felt like the Holy Spirit, no, this book is going to help you take back your thought life proactively.
Yes.
And it talks about what does it mean to nourish your mind? The power of saying no. Come on now. That's a good one.
That's a big one.
Setting boundaries. It is identifying lies, taking every thought captive. One of my favorite chapters was the whole concept of the trees of the mind. That is a powerful revelation the Lord's given you, Julie. And then things about declaring the word, remembering the testimony, worship and praise. To practical things like diet and supplements, how you're sleeping. I mean, the power of laughter. Sometimes you just might need to go and laugh, which makes me think, that was a big thing back in the 90s when Holy Spirit came with such fire and force. People were laughing. People got a little thin. And I think the Lord's flag, my people just need to laugh sometimes.
There's tremendous healing in laughter. It's amazing.
Wow. Yep. So, I'm giving you guys the contents to give you a little sneak preview of each one of those concepts is all connected to your thought life and actually taking your thought life captive and seeing healing release there so that ultimately life will follow a healthy thought life. Julie, would you mind, as we close up, again, the name of the book is Renew. You can get it wherever books are sold. I'm proud to publish this, Julie. It is an honor to work with you on this. Would you mind?
Thank you.
Would you mind, I'm going to go screen right to you. Would you pray?
Absolutely.
For our viewers, because I feel like the Lord's given you a very unusual impartation, supernatural and practical. So I'm going to turn you loose to do that.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Larry. Thank you. And I just speak a blessing and peace over the audience. So, Lord, we just ask you to come and renew our minds into the likeness of Christ. Lord, let us be joy and life and hope to a dying world. Lord, I pray you break off the lies of the enemy, the shame of pursuing treatment. We just break that off in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would just bring increased revelation to your body about how much you love us, how much you care for us, and that joy is our right, it's our inheritance, and that no matter what we're going through, we have access to a superior kingdom, a kingdom that is full of joy and peace. And so I just pray for freedom among people today. Lord, even now, that you would just reach out and touch people who are worried and anxious, and that you would just touch them with your Holy Spirit, and that you would bring freedom and light and joy. Yeah. Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen. Julie, thank you so much for being with us today. This was fun.
You're welcome. It was wonderful. Let's do it again.
We will. We totally will. And again, I want to encourage you guys, almost forgot, check Julie Winter out on Facebook.
That is where Yes, my Facebook page. That'd be great.
Yeah, that's where you can probably find the most, the latest information from her, particularly pertaining to ministry. So that's fun. Julie, thank you so much. We'll definitely do this again. And for all of our viewers, thank you so much for joining us. We'll have this on the archive. And hey, if this message is relevant to somebody you know, I encourage you to share it. If you just know somebody that would be encouraged by this particular message on renewing the mind, I encourage you to share that with whoever you think that would be most appropriate for. Blessings to you all. And we'll come to you again.
Thank you.
All right.